video, we will look at continuous models. These are more similar in spirit to the dynamic models, ODE based models we saw earlier on, but focusing on gene regulation. Let's quickly look at continuous models. This is something you are very familiar with in any case, but they are also useful in the case of regulatory network modeling. So, we have obviously real value data than discrete from most biological experiments, and you have to somehow use a threshold or something like that to discretize whatever real value data you get, right, which reduces accuracy. That is a problem. And in many cases you may want kinetics, right. We discussed at the very beginning of the course that your choice of modeling tool is going to be dictated by the kind of questions you want to answer. Do you want to do kinetics? Do you want to do steady state? Do you want to just identify who interacts with whom and so on? And you know, if you have a parameterized dynamic model, you can exploit or infer these quantitative measurements. And of course, you have the challenge of the curse of dimensionality. Right? If you have a very large number of parameters, you can never fit them. So, you have to, you know, unless you have some biological knowledge, I know that this parameter is in this range, I know that my Km lies between 0.01 and 0.08, right. Unless I have that kind of information, it becomes very difficult to estimate the parameters, and the systems can also be very sloppy, right. So, in the sense that they can show the same behavior for very large variations in parameters and so on. And what are all the processes involved? So, you have many complex processes that are involved in gene regulation, right, from transport, binding, transcription, translation, catalysis, degradation, and also some signaling events and so on. So, all these need to be described using kinetic models, and we are familiar with the same good old kinetic models. What are the classic kinetic models that we need to worry about? Michaelis-Menten kinetics, Hill kinetics, mass action kinetics. Invariably, you can represent all of these using one of these classic kinetic models. So, you need to basically take a static picture and transform it into a dynamic model of processes. So, maybe a transport will look like a reaction of this sort, binding of a metabolite to a transcription factor. So, transcription factor will take a nucleic acid and so transcription involves the conversion of a nucleic acid to an mRNA in the presence of transcription factor, then translation, amino acids to protein when mRNA is present, and then a metabolic reaction that we are very familiar with. In the presence of an enzyme, A will go to B, then a degradation, protein degrades, mRNA degrades, and you can basically write a rate function which captures the rate of all these reactions. So, you need to represent all the factors. They might be allosteric inhibitors, they may be allosteric activators, other effector molecules, ions, sensitivity to pH, whatever. All these things have to be incorporated into your dynamic model one way or the other. So, this very same system can be modeled using Boolean models if you want. They can be modeled using continuous models. You could also use FBA occasionally. But you know, FBA is not good enough to typically model some of these kinds of systems, even though you can show them as reactions. It's very difficult to write mass balance for a protein and so on, because you are talking about several amino acids, polymerization and things like that. So, the classic kinetic models again are mass action, Michaelis-Menten and Hill. Let's look at a simple system here. So, you have gene 1 activating gene 2, and gene 1 again activating gene 3. And gene 1 and gene 2 activating gene 3, and gene 3 repressing gene 1, right. So, how do the equations look like? So d gene 1 by dt is some, so in all these cases U3, you see that there is a negative contribution from the same gene. So, there is a sort of degradation rate that is captured by these constants. D gene by dt is includes a minus self term. In addition to that, you have K1 into 1 plus, this is more like your Michaelis-Menten. You can have more complex equations like this and so on, and you will end up with time courses that can be captured. The catch of course is I have to estimate K1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 different parameters for a simple system with just 3 genes, right? It can become very challenging. So, to summarize, there are several methods that are available and each of them vary in their ability to capture various details. So, for example, if you were to look at the level of detail, stochastic simulations are, you know, very detailed models, but the problem is that the models themselves are very small. Stochastic, so something like a transcription event is often could be modeled as a stochastic event, because you will have like only a few transcription factors in the cell and maybe a few RNA polymerase molecules in the cell, right. So, you are going to be worried about whether this binds to DNA and so on. So, now I am going to look at concentrations and so on, and we will start looking at distributions of numbers. So, how many polymerases are bound by transcription factors versus unbound and so on and so forth. So, how faithful are they to biological reality? Obviously, at the level of stochastic models, you are very faithful to biological reality, but you need a very large amount of data for modeling. And even though you have a very high ability to model dynamics, you can only implement very small models, right. So, you clearly see that there is a lot of trade-off involved here. And this, according to me, is one of the most important takeaways for you from this course and the series of lectures, right. When do you use what kind of model? Of course, speed of analysis again, you know, stochastic models will take a very long time to simulate, because you have to simulate various realizations and so on. And ability to perform inference, this is probably the most important thing, and this is very low in terms of stochastic models, because we are talking about system level inference. You can make very accurate predictions about a single small system. But if you are looking at a system level inference, the ability to do that really declines with the size of the, with the smaller the size of the system, lower is your ability to make these kinds of predictions. So, you will have a distribution, you will know that, you know, this is going to be my distribution, or this is going to be my distribution of whatever molecules I am, you know, number of molecules bound to transcription factor. So, what is the most likely state? You can figure that out. So, this slide essentially tells you according to several different axes, right. So, from level of detail, faithfulness to biological reality, amount of data needed, right. So, it is easier to build Boolean networks, you do not need too much data to build them. RFBA and those things are somewhat right in the middle, right. You can even put FBA down here, although we are talking about regulatory modeling here, but in general, and here in fact, if you looked at the entire course, your networks will go somewhere here, the networks we studied in the very first module. Right, and continuous is of course here, but then you are sort of limited by the size of models that you can build. Models are going to be smallish when you are looking at ODEs. So, it is clearly a trade off, and you will have to, you know, make the sacrifices necessary for the question that you want to answer. We are more interested in modeling dynamics, then you are limited to this half of you know, models to the right of this bar, right. If you are very interested in you know, making very large system and prediction, you want to look at somewhere here, right. Or if you want to be very accurate, you want to look at somewhere here. But then again, you would not be able to simulate a very large system. So, you clearly have trade-offs to make and figure out. The models can provide important insights into regulation and metabolism and ideally guide experimentation. And obviously, we have different types of models, and the choice depends on what is the question you want to address. You want to know if this interaction is going to happen or not, you may survive with a very simple model. You want to know what is the rate at which this signaling pathway kicks in when this sort of shock is given to the cell, then you will need a maybe a dynamic model, right. So, depending upon the question that you want to answer, you need to pick the right kind of model. And logical models based on Boolean networks are easy to build and analyze, and they are somewhat quite powerful. We look at some hands-on in the next class. And ODE models are great, excellent for doing dynamics, as long as you can surmount two things. One, availability of data. Two, parameter estimation, right. And both are sort of, I would say, not exactly orthogonal, but both can be issues, right. Even if you have a lot of data, if you have too many parameters to estimate, you are not going to go anywhere. And if you do not have a lot of data, you are already at a very big disadvantage to start off with. And tools like RFBA or integrated FBA, there are ways to, you know, integrate genomic data into models and so on. So all these are useful because they can extend FBA for modeling, regulation and even signaling if you want. So essentially marry FBA with some discrete modeling framework. You take FBA and connect it to, say, you know, Boolean rules for various regulators and so on, which is what is RFBA. You can do it similarly for signaling and so on. Stochastic models are very useful, I mean very powerful to make realistic modeling and simulation, but they are very difficult to implement in practice, and well, they can make only small, you can make only small size inferences. So there are very nice stochastic models of chemotaxis and things like that, but you seldom have stochastic models of an entire cell and so on. So these are some very good references. I will post them to the class website. So this is a very good review that overviews FBA and a lot of what we have studied in here. This was one of the classic Boolean network modeling papers, these two. This is the abscisic acid signaling paper. This is the classic RFBA paper, and this is another nice review. So you can basically figure out where all the action is or where all your doubts are, and then, so this is in fact how one likes to go about modeling in general, right? So you first you know, have some, start with some hypothesis, right? Or if you have data, then you have a model, you simulate or validate, and compare with data, right? So does it agree or not, right? So depending on this, you basically figure out what are the changes, or you know, in fact, or can this tell you new experiments or new hypothesis? This would be the best contribution, right? Can you perform the most informative experiment, the one useful experiment that you want to do based on the current set of data and observations, simulations?
Sir, how will you create adjacency metrics for logical models? Like you take some matrix randomly.
So there are other ways to simulate. So, so you may just, you know, so you can just simulate. So let's say GI is some So you can just say the state of this is greater than some threshold theta, right? So this will be a different way to simulate. It is not a true logical, this is not a Boolean network based model, but if you have an adjacency matrix, you can also simulate. So I have like 10 regulatory genes, each having some weight, some having plus weights and some having minus weights, and if the total effect is greater than some theta, I will assume that this is turning on or off or something like that. So in this video, I hope you got a good overview of continuous models and also a nice summary of the different kinds of models that one can use for modeling gene regulation, and when one likes to use them, and what are the kind of efforts involved in modeling, and what are the kind of outputs you get from the model and so on. In the next video, we will do a lab wherein we use this simple JavaScript based tool called BoolSim to simulate a Boolean network, a simple Boolean network.